The government has eased norms to make schemes more attractive for investors in special economic zones, or SEZs. Abhishek Goenka, partner at BMR Advisors, now joins us in business of discussing if these changes really will have an impact. Abhishek, thank you for joining us. Let me begin by asking you about what you made of the sort of reclassification on the minimum size that's required and so on. Some of these have been long-standing demands. Some of it seems to be mere tweaking. How do you read this?
Harsha, as you said, some of it is mere tweaking, but I think some of the changes actually go beyond that. For example, if you look at the change made for the IT and ITES SEZs, the minimum land requirement has been completely done away with, and instead there's now only a minimum built-up area requirement, which is also in a graded fashion depending on the city. So I think that's a fairly big change. It will result in several new IT SEZs coming up across the country. And even the change for multi-sector SEZs where the land size has been reduced, from 1,000 hectares to 500 hectares, I think will make a big difference because clearly land aggregation was one big challenge for SEZ developers. And while 500 hectares still remains a big task, I think at least it's a step in the right direction.
Abhishek, the key question is this too little, too late? Will corporates bite?
It's a step in the right direction, but not enough, Harsha. I think ever since the government made those two changes on the tax side, where they introduced minimum alternate tax and took away the dividend distribution tax exemption, the whole SEZ story has been taken off the radar of corporates. It doesn't remain as attractive as it used to be. So I think while these changes are good, what the government needs to do further is to provide a very clear exit mechanism. So this policy or this change falls short of announcing an exit policy for developers. And also the lack of clarity on the non-processing area developments on residential, hotels, convention centers, basically all the support infrastructure, that policy still remains very, very nebulous. And I think unless that is resolved, the interest in large-scale SEZ developments will still remain quite muted.
For someone who's put in money in a special economic zone, a project that is, and who's looking to exit, Abhishek, what is the clarity that is required? What does he need from the government in terms of rules to say, look, this is what I need to know?
Well, you know, until a year back, even when developers sought to sell their shareholding in SEZs, it required an approval from the government, and in many cases, the approvals are rejected. Fortunately, ever since, there's been some clarity. The government has laid out specific situations and conditions that need to be followed. But I would have liked to see that in the rules, rather than that being a discretion exercise by the Board of Approvals each time an application is put before it. So, you know, very simply, we need the ability for developers to be able to sell buildings as they develop parts of the SEZ, which is still not clear in the law. We need developers to be able to unbundle a company into multiple entities, whether through demergers or through sale of assets, again, something that should be freely permitted. And the last thing, like I said, we need full clarity on sale of shares. We can't have developers being at the mercy of specific discretionary approvals being given by the Board of Approvals. One must remember that the whole SEZ process is ultimately a business. Sure. And while developers do get concessions, they need to have the ability to exit as and when they desire.
There have also been questions and doubts in the past regarding contiguous land parcels. There have been delays in land acquisition. Do you think some of these changes address these concerns?
To some extent, they do, Harsha. I think one of the changes that's important here is the fact that you can now add land on which existing structures are there as long as there's no activity going on those structures. So to that extent, the whole aggregation of land will become much simpler because you can include structures that are already in existence. That's one. The other change which will make a big difference is the broadbanding of sectors and the fact that for every 50 hectares of land that you add into an SEZ, you can include another sector within the ambit of that SEZ. So I think these changes are in line with the sort of overall reductions in the land size. And I think this will make land aggregation and, you know, the proliferation of SEZs much more rampant across the country.